We welcome everyone this morning, and we certainly give God praise for blessing us, allowing us to be able to come into his house one more time, and for that we're thankful. We just lift him up and we magnify his name because we realize that there is no one like him, amen, and we just appreciate his love and his kindness toward us, amen. We magnify his name. We magnify his name and we give him praise. Amen. We just lift him up. We realize that there's nobody like him. Everyone needs to have a mask on that's inside the sanctuary. We thank God. We give God praise. We're going to pray at this time. We're going to pray at this time. Come on, let's bow our heads. Lord Jesus, our great God and our King of glory, Lord, we come before you today and we magnify your name. Hallelujah. Lord, we're so thankful for your amazing grace, your kindness toward us. We're so thankful, Lord Jesus, because we realize, Lord, that there is none like you. And we just love you, Lord, and we appreciate you for all that you're doing. And Lord, we ask you to give us a word today. Bless us, Lord. Meet us in this place. Lord, in this world, in these crucial times, we need a visit from you, Lord. We need your help. We need your sustaining power. We need your keeping power, Lord. Hallelujah. We need the power of your love and the power of your presence. Hallelujah, Lord. Millions, millions, millions didn't make it. But Lord, thus far, we are one of the ones who did, and we want to thank you. Hallelujah. You have kept us. Oh, hallelujah. You have sustained us. You have, Lord, kept us, Lord Jesus, in the midst of despair, in the midst of hurt, in the midst of loss, in the midst, Lord Jesus, of uncertainty. Hallelujah. You have done it. And for that, Lord, we give you praise today. Now you bless us, Lord, and meet us here in this place. In the name of Jesus, touch all of our listeners that are listening to the live stream. Touch those here in the sanctuary and those who are making their way to the sanctuary. You just meet us here, Lord, and do what only you're capable of doing. And for that, Lord, we thank you and we give you praise. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We want to welcome everyone. And we certainly thank God because we realize he is so good. We realize that he is so good and he is so worthy to be praised. And there is nobody like him. Aren't you glad for Jesus today? Oh, come on, clap your hands. Don't pity Pat. But give him some praise because he is worthy to be praised. We certainly thank God today. We thank God and we want to also want to say happy birthday to my mother. Today is her birthday. Amen. And God has blessed her. And she says she's feeling great at 88. Amen. So we just give God praise for that. Amen. Some folk at 88 ain't feeling nothing. But we thank God that he has blessed her. Amen. And also my nephew, born on the same day, Adrian Gordon, he's in the house at his birthday too. Amen. So we thank God for him as well. Amen. It's a blessing, you know. If you didn't value birthdays after what we've been through the last 20 months, I guarantee you people are valuing birthdays now. Because we realize it's always been a blessing, but it's really a blessing now for God to keep us and allow us to see another birthday. Also want to say I want to thank God for all those who came out and were able to be a part of our virtual Faith Works conference that we participated in. And God blessed us and we got a word, and we just thank God for that. Amen. It's always a blessing when we can get a word from God. Amen. And we just appreciate those of you who took the time to spend almost your whole day listening to what God was saying through His Word, through the Faith Works Conference. And we hope that you were able to link and tune in on Friday night. But if you weren't, you still can go to Apostolic Faith Church YouTube channel and be able to listen to the Friday night service as well. So we thank God for each of you. By way of our service schedule, we continue to live stream on Sunday, amen, and be right here giving God the praise at 10:30 a.m. from the sanctuary. And for all those members who are at home drinking coffee right now, I want you to know we're still coming together in the sanctuary, amen? Amen. Put that piece of bacon down, put those eggs away, and come on to the sanctuary, amen. And for those of you who are listening in other places, we want to thank God for all of you. And as we continue to say each Sunday, one thing the Lord has let me know, He said, don't try to measure what the ministry is doing by who's sitting in the chairs in the sanctuary on Sunday morning. Because I can tell you these live stream services have been reaching a lot of people, anywhere from 7 to 15 different states every service, and many times 2 or 3 foreign countries. As you heard me say earlier, we've had people from China to tune in. We've had people from Germany to tune in. And we've got some new people who are tuning in every Sunday from Singapore. So you don't know who you're reaching. Just let God be God, amen. And He will be able to be a blessing in the lives of people. We'll continue to live stream by way of Bible class. We pray that you were able to study in the book of John, chapter number 3. And we always hear people quote John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen? Amen. So we hope that you were blessed by reading in chapter 3 of John this past week for our Bible lesson study. We'll be posting another one this week for you to study. And don't just bypass it and not go to it. I guarantee you, if you go to the Word of God, God has something to say to you, and it will be a blessing in your life. Get ready. On Sunday, October the 31st, Southtown is going outside to the parking lot. But y'all, we're gonna double it up this time for our outdoor service. Amen. And we're going to put it on the devil so bad every time he think about Southtown coming to the parking lot, he's going to say, ooh, that's a scary thought. Amen. Because we're going to have some church outside. Amen. And we're also going to be doing something for the children as well, since it's going to be on Halloween. Amen. We're going to do something, amen, to show our young children that we can celebrate. We can celebrate and praise God besides giving the devil any credit and any praise. Amen. We're going to get on the devil's day and slam him. Amen. In the name of Jesus. We will have a prayer tent set up where people can come and get prayer. We're going to have some cars lined up with some treats in them where the kids can go get some treats. We're going to have a food truck on location where you can go out and get something to eat and you don't have to pay for it. But I'm going to limit how much you can get, though. But anyway, you don't have to pay for it. Amen. Amen. So we're looking for a great time in the Lord. And of course, our dynamic singers will be there singing to bless us. Amen. Our ministers of music, Deacon Stephen Gordon and Sister Randy Gordon. Our lick lady, Sister Shirley Gordon. We're going to have some church. Amen. And my friend, the dynamic Charles Luster, is going to link up with me. We're going to be praying for people. Amen. People going to leave here shouting the victory. Amen. As to what God has done. We're going to have a lot of good fellowship and fun. So please mark your calendars. Sunday, October 31st, 10:30 a.m. outside on the parking lot at Southtown Apostolic Church. Amen. We want to thank God for our givers who continue to give, continue to sow a seed into this ministry. And one thing that amazes me about giving, it's amazing when someone can give and not even be here locally as a part of this ministry, but yet they'll be able to sow a seed unto what God is doing. Amen? And a lot of times when you talk about giving, people will be quick to say that Jesus paid it all. Well, no, he didn't. He wants you to give something. Amen. And if you give, God will bless you for what you do. One thing I found out about giving, too, if you don't give, then your hand is like this. And if your hand is closed up, you may not be given nothing, but try to receive something with your hand closed. So you can't receive anything either. So the way to receive is to give. And when you open up your hand to give, God will send something your way where you can receive. And so we're so thankful unto the Lord for all those who continue to give and continue to bless this church. And I want to say something again, too. I said earlier that my mother turned 88 today. And I want to say that my mother has always been a faithful giver to this church. And she hasn't stopped giving because she's out of town with my sister. She continues to call me and said, boy, give my offering today. Pay my tithes. Amen. She continues to give. And that's what God likes, is faithfulness. Amen. So thank God for all the givers, all the givers. Let's give ourselves a hand. God made it all possible through us. Amen. Because of what we're doing for this ministry. And as we go forward, church, we're going to be looking for ways, and I want y'all to be thinking of ideas as well. We want to look for ways where we can reach some of our young people in this community. Amen. We are dealing with the first generation of unchurched young people who have never went to church, have never been introduced to Christ, don't know anything about salvation, don't know anything about relationship with God. And we've got to learn and ask God to give us wisdom for ways as to how we can reach them. Amen. And so that's what we're going to be doing. Amen. God is going to bless us to be able to do some things to reach some of our young people. And one thing we've got to learn is that we can't jump up and beat them down and then expect to win them. But God has to give us wisdom and show us how to win them. Amen. Amen. So let God bless you with some thoughts and ideas that you might be able to bless this ministry, that we might be able to go forward and do some things in Jesus' name. Is that all right? Yes. Amen. We thank God. We give God praise. If you want to give today, you can raise your hand and someone will give you an envelope, and you can put your offering in an envelope and drop it in the box by the door. Or you can use our Givelify app. Go to Givelify and give. Or you can use our PayPal account and give. Or you can drop it in the U.S. Postal Service P.O. Box 725, South County Apostolic Church, Mount Vernon, Illinois. Amen. And give that way. And God will bless you for what you do. Amen. Amen. So we thank God for all givers and what you give. May God bless you in Jesus' name. All right, it's time for song. Amen. Our singers are coming one more time to bless us. Amen. And we just get excited every time they come because they're always such a blessing to us. And we just give God praise for them. So at this time, our ministers of music, amen, Deacon Stephanie Gordon, Sister Randy Gordon, and our elect lady, Sister Shirley Gordon, are coming to bless us in Jesus' name. Can we say amen?
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Anybody come to give God praise today? Anybody come to give God praise today? Amen. Hallelujah. Anybody come to give God praise today? Hallelujah. Can I get two or three people to get into it with us today? Can I get two or three people to stand on your feet and help us lift up the name of Jesus? Hallelujah.
Nobody greater, nobody
great God and our King of glory. Lord, we stand at the foot of your throne. And we ask, Lord, for a word from you. Lord, we need to hear from you. In the midst, Lord, of these struggles, in the midst of these storms, in the midst of these days of uncertainty, we need the power of your sustaining word that will help us to be able to stand. That we would be able to declare, no matter what's going on, that Jesus is the solid rock I stand, and all of the ground is sinking sand. Lord, we look to you. Lord, we depend on you. Lord, we hold on to you. Because we realize, Lord, that's where our help comes from. Amen. Now, Lord, give us a word today. Give us a word that will change us. Give us a word, Lord, that will allow us, oh God, to put forth our best effort. Put forth, Lord, our best effort for your glory. That when people look upon our lives, they will see the light of Christ shining. That it would shine so that you would get the glory. And Lord, we thank you for the power of your word. Now, Lord, send down your anointing. Send down, Lord, your power. Let this your servant decrease that you might increase, and bless the hearers of your word. Lord, someone out there listening to the live stream need a breakthrough. Someone out there listening to the live stream need a ray of hope in their lives. Somebody needs strength, Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Somebody's about to give up, Lord. But Lord, your word is sustaining power. Your word, Lord, your word, your word, your word, when it comes, where there seems like there is no hope, hope begins. Your word, Lord, when it comes where there seems like there is no victory, victory shows up. Your word, Lord, when it comes in the midst of brokenheartedness, when it comes in the midst of loss, when it comes in the midst of storms, when your word shows up, Lord, peace shows up.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Oh, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory, glory, glory. Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, ho, ho, ho. Glory, glory, glory. 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 We need you, Lord. Now you bless us. In Jesus' name. It is found in the Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter number 9. And we want to begin reading in verse number 8. Verse number 2, rather. And the word of God reads, "And after 6 days, Jesus taketh him Peter and James and John, and leadeth them up unto a high mountain, apart by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his raiment became shining, exceedingly white as snow, so as to no fuller on earth can white them. And there appeared unto them Elias and Moses, and they were talking with Jesus. And Peter answered and said to Jesus, Master, it is good for us to be here. Let us make 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias. And while it's not what to say, for they were so afraid, and there was a cloud that overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud saying, This is my beloved Son, hear him. And suddenly, when they had looked round about, they saw no man anymore, save Jesus only with themselves." And from this 8th verse is where we want to take our subject today. That they saw no man anymore save Jesus only. And for the subject that I want us to think on, for as long as the Lord says the same, the subject is this: we don't need another hero. Can you say that with me? We don't need another hero. Now let's make it personal before we take our seats and say, I don't need another hero. I don't need another hero. You may be seated. We don't need another hero. And as we let our minds go to where we are at this time in our lives, in our world, in our country, and it seems like that everyone is looking for a hero. Everyone is looking for a hero who will bring the answers that we need in this world in which we live today. In a world that is faced with a number of problems and issues. As we stand and sit here today, in a world that, in a country that's called the greatest nation in the world, where it has become so that a large majority of our citizens can't afford to have health care, to be able to go and see a physician when they become ill. And it is said in some places that when you walk through the door and you don't have insurance, they turn you around or send you to the facility across town that does not have the quality of doctors that you need in your situation. And because of the lack, and y'all stay with me, I'm going somewhere. And because of the lack of affordable health care, so many people are walking our streets today suffering from mental illness. They have lost their ability to be able to think right. They have lost their ability to be able to make good decisions. They have lost their ability even to be able to function in a normal way of humanity, because they're not getting the help or treatment that they need because they don't have affordable health care. And then if you would look at where our country is, you look at how our country is spending money. And I know when I was growing up, I was always taught, don't spend more than you take in. Live within your means. But we're living in a country that runs a deficit on a regular basis of trillions of dollars of debt. More debt than income. Amen. And because of this, the future of my grandchildren and your grandchildren is questioned as to where will America be 10 years from now. Someone's looking for a hero to solve the healthcare issue. They're looking for a hero to solve the budget deficit. They're looking for a hero to solve the crime problem, to solve the illegal immigration problem, to where people are leaving the country that they live in because things are so bad and they don't even have the basic necessities of life, and they're willing to risk their lives, risk their children's lives, walk thousands of miles to try to find a better life and willing to die for it. I'm telling you, someone is looking for a hero that can solve the problem, amen. Solve the problem where the 1% won't have all the wealth and the 99% have to struggle to try to make it. That the rich countries won't have all the wealth and not have a godly attitude to be able to share. Let me tell you something. God has never blessed any of us with more than what we need for us to keep it all to ourselves. There's a reason why you have a surplus. Because God is going to put somebody on your heart for you to go and be a blessing in their lives. Hallelujah. All of us can think about a time at some point in our life when we needed someone to help us and God opened up a door and sent somebody our way to be a blessing to us. Amen. But people are looking for a hero. Amen. But I want you to think about something here. As we face these problems and these struggles in our country, as we face, amen, the crime problem, you don't even know if you can go to the store and back, amen, and make it home safe. Except we realize that we trust God, amen, to cover us, amen, and to order our footsteps. But if it had not been for the Lord, amen, who was on our side, amen, the crime wave would have caught up with us by now. I tell you, amen, and not only that, but they're looking for somebody. They're looking for someone who can solve the gun violence, amen. I never thought I would see a day where, I know when high school, when I was in high school, it was one of the happiest times of my life. It was always something going on in high school. We had so much fun, amen. And we didn't worry about somebody coming to the school and bringing a gun and shooting up the classroom. That was even on our mind, but look at our world in which we live today, amen. It is a shame when you see school teachers crying like a baby because somebody came and shot up the classroom, amen. I'm telling you, everybody's looking for someone who will solve these problems, amen. And then when we look and see the coronavirus that have taken millions of lives in this world, 700,000 Americans already gone, amen, and they're not coming back because of this virus. And I know that it seems like, amen, everybody's looking to President Biden to try to find the solution, amen, and they want to give his poll numbers lower numbers because it don't seem like that things are turning around fast enough. But let me tell you something. You can't look to President Biden to be able to solve these problems. But your hero, you got to look in the right place to get the right hero. Amen. When we look at the problem that we have in this country, the problem of racism, the problem of hate, the problem of a divided nation, I'm trying to show y'all the picture as to where we are right now, even as we sit in this church, amen, at the problem of homelessness, the problem of people getting up in the morning and don't even know where they're going to sleep tonight, getting up in the morning and don't even know where they're going to go and change clothes, don't even know where they're going to go and eat a meal. I tell y'all, they're looking for a hero who can turn this thing around. Hallelujah. They're looking for a hero who can solve the unemployment problem. They're looking for a hero who can solve the climate change problem. And I could go on with the number of problems, but there's too many to name. But I want to tell y'all something today. The top problem that we have in the United States of America, and the top problem that we have in this world, is that we have too many people with no relationship with God. Too many people with no church life. We're raising a generation of young people. I will never forget a couple years ago, we were getting ready to go on a field trip. And we had a group of children sitting in the gymnasium on the bleachers. And I told them, I said, before we leave to go to the zoo in St. Louis, I want to have a word of prayer. I want to pray God's blessings upon us over the highways. I want to pray that God will bless us as we walk around in the zoo. I want to pray that God will bring us back safely. And there was a little girl sitting in the bleachers, and she tapped on the little girl that was sitting next to her. And she asked the little girl, she said, what is prayer? She didn't even know what prayer was. And the little girl said, when you pray, you talk to God. She said, well, how do you pray? She didn't even know how to pray, and she didn't know what prayer was. I'm telling y'all, we got to do something to get these young people with a relationship with God, because that's who is the hero. This hero that we call Jesus, the Bible tells us he is our hero. And not only that, but there's something about our God. He's tougher than Superman. They said Superman is able to jump small buildings in a single bounce. They said Superman, amen, can bounce bullets off his chest. But Superman ain't nothing when it comes to our God. The Bible tells us that this God that we serve, he is omni, he is omnipotent. In other words, he is omni, he's all powerful. He's got all the power in his hands. Amen. And not only that, but he is omniscient. In other words, he's present everywhere. Hallelujah. And not only that, he's omniscient. He's all-knowing. This God we serve, we've got a hero who has all the power. We got a hero who is everywhere. We've got a hero that knows all about our everyday struggle. When no one else knows what you're going through, he knows all about it. He knows, hallelujah, the Bible says, he is so powerful that he knows our uprisings. He knows our down settings. He knows our thoughts are far off. He knows what we're in need of even before we ask. The Bible tells us he's able to see us through. Amen. The Bible gives us to know through the word of God that we have a hero by the name of Jesus. And I want to tell you something. My definition of a hero is somebody that shows up and rescues you in the nick of time. When it was almost too late, they showed up and rescued you in the nick of time. The Bible tells us that the Lord had it in his plan to be a hero. The Bible tells us when he created man and put him in the garden and man messed up and man got put out. I don't know if any of you have ever messed up. I don't know if any of you have ever got put out, but not only did they get put out, but they were in such bad shape until the Lord said, I'm not just going to put them out, but I'm going to put guards at the gate because they're in such bad shape. I don't want them coming back up into the Garden of Eden. So he placed the angels there with the flaming swords to keep them out of the garden. But one thing I like about this God we serve, he is my hero. One thing I like about him, when you feel like there is no hope for you, he is a God of second chances. He didn't put him out just to punish him, but he put him out to bless him. He put him out so they weren't able to go back in there and eat of the tree of life and live forever in sin. But even when he put him out, he started working on a plan to get them back to the place where God intended for us to be in the first place. And the Bible tells us that the Lord began to deal with man. And as he dealt with man, he began to deal with man in dispensations. Dispensation is a period of time in which God deals with men in a particular way. The Bible tells us that the first one was innocent when they were there in the garden. Can you imagine being at the state Adam and Eve were? They could couldn't think nothing bad. They couldn't see nothing bad. They couldn't say nothing bad. They had it made. But when the devil tricked them, when they got put out of the garden, the Lord said, and now you gonna be at the deal, and let your conscience be your guide. So they were in the dispensation of conscience. So they knew right and they knew wrong. He said, now you can choose. Do right and give me the glory. Do wrong and suffer the consequences. But man kept failing God. And then the Lord came along in the dispensation of human government. The Lord said, I'm going to give y'all another chance. I'm going to let you govern yourselves. But I want you to do it according to my command. And y'all know what the story is. The Lord told them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. But the Bible gives us to know that man still failed God. They said, we're not going nowhere. We having a good time. Y'all know how churches do sometime nowadays. We don't want to leave the sanctuary and take this thing to the streets and let men and women everywhere know that the God we serve, he can save you. He can turn your life around. He can bring you out. It's something wrong somewhere when the church can sit back and see our young men going to prison 50 years at a time. It's something wrong somewhere when we can sit back and watch our young people killing one another on the street. It's something wrong somewhere when we can sit back and see our children going hungry. It's something wrong somewhere. But the Lord said, replenish the earth. And so they decided that they were so smart, they were going to build a tower up into heaven. And so they start building that tower, the Tower of Babel. And the Bible said the Lord had to stop them, because if God wouldn't have stopped them, they would have succeeded at what they were doing. So the Lord came down, and at that time, everybody on the face of the earth spoke the same language. So the Lord came down, and he confused the language. No longer could the neighbor understand his neighbor because they spoke a different language. And so everybody, they spoke the same language. They had to get together and go to other parts of the world and build their own cities because God's will was going to be done. And you know how it is in the dispensation of promise. God sent the prophets, told the people, if you do this, God's going to do this. But man still failed. Hallelujah. You know that you wouldn't put up with nobody as much as God has put up with us. If your best friend would have let you down twice, you would have been finished with them. You wouldn't even be speaking. You would have blocked them on Facebook. You would have let the answering machine pick up their calls. But look at God. He came and promised. And he promised them, if you do this, then I'll do this. But man still failed God. And then the Lord came. Hallelujah. In the midst of the desert, there was a shepherd by the name of Moses. He saw a burning bush, and God spoke to him out of the burning bush and told him to go tell Pharaoh, I said, let my people go. And the Bible tells us, Moses began to make excuses. I know I don't have nobody in the church or nobody listening at the live stream. Whoever make excuses to God as to the why, but I want you to know Moses made excuses, but to make a long story short, he ended up going and doing God's work, and God was with him, and he brought Israel out of Egypt after over 400 years in bondage. And the Bible tells us, hallelujah, in the midst of the law, amen, when they were wandering in the wilderness and God took them to the promised land. And when they got to the promised land, amen, the Bible gives us to know, amen, along came John the Baptist later on. And John was a voice crying in the wilderness. John said, prepare the way and make the way straight, because a hero is coming. There's a hero coming behind me. John said, I'm not the one. He said, I must decrease so that he can increase. John realized what his mission was. He realized he couldn't take Jesus' place. He realized that there wasn't nobody like Jesus. And the Bible tells us, out of all our failures, out of all our mistakes, out of all our mess ups, God still loved us. He said, I tell you what I'm going to do. Hallelujah, I love him so much. I'm going to leave my throne in glory. I'm going to come down 42 generations. I'm going to leave my throne. I'm going to leave the presence of my throne. And I'm going to come down and get among men and robe myself in flesh. Come through the world through a Virgin Mary. And they shall call my name Jesus, because I'm going to be the Savior of the world. I'm going to be somebody that there's nobody like. And the Bible gives us to know. So he came and he prepared for 32 and a half years. And he started his ministry. And then it was time for him to go to Calvary's cross. And the Bible gives us to know the thing that the devil stole from us. Way back in the Garden of Eden, the Lord said, I'm your hero. I'm going to give you eternal life back. I'm going to give you relationship back. I'm going to give you a name you can call that's above every name. I'm going to give you a name you can call what devils tremble. I'm going to give you a name you can call that will turn around every situation. I'm going to give you a name you can call that will be hope in the midst of despair. I'm going to give you a name you can call that will be joy in sorrow. I'm going to give you a name you can call that you feel like you can't go on. It will stir up something in your life that will give you peace, that will make you run on, that will make you hang on, that will make you hold on. We don't need another hero. If you're looking for your hero, and President Biden is not in Biden, is not in Steph Curry, is not in Ezekiel Elliott, is not in Donald Trump, is not in the Congress, is not in Madea, is not in Pookie, is not in Bebe, but it's in Jesus. All you need is Jesus. We don't need another hero, but we got Jesus, and that's enough for us. The Bible tells us when Jesus came down, he walked down 42 generations. He said, I'm going to go to the grave, because the devil thought that he had him. Is anybody here that the devil put you through pure hell? He put you in a place you've never been before, and he thought he had you. He thought you wasn't coming out. no way you was coming out of this thing, but the Lord, he came down. He said, I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take on death, and I'm going to take on the grave. I'm going to take them on, and death and the grave, they got together. Y'all know how people get together on us when they don't want you to come out, when they don't want you to be blessed, when they don't want you to have joy, when they don't want you to do better, when they don't want you to give God glory. They get together on you. They lie on you. They talk about you. They plot against you. So death and the grave, they got together. And grave told death, if you get him, I'll show enough keep him. Hallelujah. Death said, I'm going to get him. Grave said, I'm going to keep him. But the Bible says, Jesus said, bring it on, because somebody need a hero in their life. Somebody need a winner in their life. Somebody need a victory in their life. Bring it on. The Bible says that he went to the cross and he laid down his life. And matter of fact, he told his apostles, he said, I'm going to Calvary. He said, he's going to kill me. But he said, I want you to know, don't be in despair. Don't be discouraged. Because on the third day, I'm going to get up again. On the third day, I'm going to rise again. When the Bible tells us that they put him in the grave. They put the stone at the tomb. Hallelujah. His apostles, out of all they had been through, out of all they had seen, they were still afraid. Let me tell y'all something. You better remember what God already did in your life. You better remember where he's already brought you from. You better remember the victory he's already given you. You better remember how he turned it around the last time that the devil told you it wasn't going to get no better. Let me tell y'all something. If I don't never preach again, I'm going to preach this thing today, because somebody need a hero. Somebody need a God that is able. Is there anybody here that will stand on their feet and say he's able? Hallelujah. I want you to think about the miracle you need and tell the devil, say he's able. He's able. He's able. He's able. He's able to fix it. He's able to turn it around. He's able to bring me out. The Bible tells us that they had him in the grave. One night went by. Death said, I still got him. Two nights went by. Death said, I still got him. Grave said, I'm still holding him. But on the third day, death said, something is going on here. Something is wrong here. And the Bible tells us, hallelujah, that death couldn't hold him. The grave couldn't keep him. He got up from the grave. He got up, hallelujah. Even before Jesus got up from the grave, because he is a hero, because of who he is, because of the way that he is, when they put him in the grave, dead folk got up, couldn't stay down there. Say, I can't be in his presence. He's too mighty. Let me tell you something. I don't care what you've been through. When God shows up, you can live again. When God shows up, you can walk again. When God shows up, you can rejoice again. When God shows up, you can be renewed again. When God shows up, So the dead, they were walking around town. They said, what happened? How did you get up? They said, we couldn't stay down because Jesus came down. And when he came down into the grave, we couldn't stay dead, but we had to get up from there. And the Bible tells us when Jesus got up from the grave and left the tomb, and he told them, he said, I'm going to Jerusalem. Yeah. And when the women came to the sepulcher, the stone had already been rolled away. Yes. And an angel was sitting on top of the stone.
Yeah.
This angel was kind of cool too. Because this angel said, I know who you're looking for. He's not there. He has arisen. And the women took off running, Sister Franny, to go and tell everybody. Amen?
Yeah.
And so they ran, and everybody they ran into, they told them Jesus has risen. And when Jesus got to Jerusalem, let me tell y'all something. Jesus, apostles, had seen him raised to dead. They had seen him walk on water.
Amen.
They had saw him give the blind their sight back. They had saw him rebuke demons. But yet they had forgot who he was. They forgot his work. They forgot how mighty he is. Let me tell y'all something. The enemy wants you to forget who Jesus is.
Yeah.
He wants you to forget what Jesus is able to do.
Yeah.
So they were back there locked up in a room hiding from the devil that they have power over.
Yeah.
And the Bible tells us when Jesus got to the room, he didn't knock on the door. You know what he did? He just walked through the wall. And when he walked through the wall, he had to say peace, because if he hadn't said peace, they was going to tear that room up getting out of there. And he ministered to them. And then he took them out on the Mount of Olives and taught them and told them to go to all the world and preach the gospel. And at that time, there was over 500 people listening to Jesus. And he told them, I want y'all to go to Jerusalem and wait there till you be endued with power from on high. And the Bible tells us out of 500 people, only 120 went to Jerusalem like Jesus told them to do. 380 people had something else more important to do than to do what Jesus told them to do. But the 120 said, he's my hero. I got to go to Jerusalem. And we know what he did, don't we? He filled them with the Holy Spirit. The church age begun. And we've been praising Jesus ever since. And let me tell you what else happened. When salvation came and Jesus came, I remember when my life was in a shamble. My life was in shambles. I was hooked on dope. I was alcoholic. I was a thief. I was a liar. I was a robber. I was on my way to hell. Most people that knew me said, he ain't no good. My nickname was, that the world had for me, was riffraff. Now, if you look up the definition of riffraff, you know what that means, and I'm walking around grinning when they call me that. But the Lord came into my life. The Lord came into my bedroom in the middle of my jacked up life and told me, I've got another life for you. You can choose me and choose life, or you can keep going the way that you're going, and you're not going to be here. And y'all know what I did? I said, Jesus, did I ever tell you you're my hero? He's my hero. He saved me. He helped me when I couldn't help myself. He delivered me from alcohol, and I didn't go to AA. He delivered me from drugs, and I didn't go to Narcotics Anonymous. He gave me a new walk. He gave me a new talk. He gave me new joy. He gave me new peace. He gave me more power. And I'm not looking for another hero, because we don't need another hero. Because our hero is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen? He's our hero. Amen? Daniel said, he's my hero. Amen. Peter says, he's my hero. Paul said, he's my hero. The woman with the issue of blood said, he's my hero. Bartimaeus went roadside and said, that's my hero, Jesus. Have mercy on me. And the Lord healed him and blessed him. Amen. One more thing I want to say, and then we're going to pray. There are a lot of people in situations in their life that they cannot change except Jesus. Be given a chance. One example I want to give you, and then I'm going to close. There was a man in the Bible. First of all, he was possessed with demons. Let me tell y'all something. The demonic world is real. Do y'all hear me? The demonic world is real. People are possessed with demons who are controlling them and making them do foolish things. And the Bible said that this man, listen to that now, he had lost his mind and he was living in the tomb with dead folk. And he would take sharp stones and cut himself. And everybody in town was afraid of him. They would go out and chain him to the wall. And no matter how many chains they put on him, he would break the chains. Now I want you to think about what kind of life was he living? What kind of hope did he have? What kind of future did he have? But y'all know what? One day along came Jesus. And the Bible lets us know the people thought Jesus was crazy to go out there dealing with that man. But Jesus spoke to those demons and said, loose him and let him go. And when he spoke to those demons asked Jesus, well, where can we go? Now, let me tell you something. Jesus, our God is so powerful until he rebuked the demons out of the man. But then the demons could even go nowhere except God gave them permission as to where they could go. So they said, Lord, you put us out of him. We don't have nowhere to go because we can only go where you permit us to go. And they asked the Lord, can they get in those sheep over there on the hill? And the Bible says Jesus allowed them to go get in the sheep. And as soon as those demons got in those sheep, what do you think those sheep done? They jumped off the mountain in the water and drowned themselves. Demonic forces will destroy your life if you don't have an encounter with our hero, and his name is Jesus. The Bible said they saw this man that had been living in the tomb. You know what he was doing? He was walking around town in his right mind, whistling and singing and giving God the glory because God delivered him. when everybody else had gave up on him, when everybody else had, was afraid of him, when everybody else didn't see no hope in him. But Jesus came along. And I want you to know, wherever you are, whoever you are, I don't care what plight you find yourself in, look to the real hero. And his name is Jesus. See, you can be sick and go to the doctor, and the doctor be quick to tell you, well, that's not my specialty. I have to send you to somebody else, because I don't deal with that type of sickness. Do y'all hear me? But not with Jesus. Jesus does all things well. With Jesus, all things are possible. Y'all know we sing that song, we say he's a doctor in the sick room. Yes. He's a lawyer in the courtroom.
Yes.
He's my water when I'm thirsty. He's my bread when I'm hungry. He's my strength when I'm weak.
Yes.
Now if that's not a hero, I don't know who he is.
Amen.
Be blessed and let the hero come into your life and he will change your life. God bless you and God keep you in Jesus' name.